didn't know today would be our last, or that I'd have to say goodbye to you so fast. I'm so numb, I can't feel anymore. I'm praying you'd just walk back through that door and tell me that I was only dreaming. You're not really gone as long as I believe. There will be another angel around the throne tonight. Your love lives on inside of me, and I will hold on tight. Not my place to question, only God knows why. I'm just jealous of the angels around the throne tonight. Always made my troubles feel so small, and you were always there to catch me when I'd fall. In a world where heroes come and go, well, God just took the only one I know. So I'll hold you as close as I can, longing for the day when I see your face again. But until then, God must need another angel around the throne tonight. Your love lives on inside of me, and I will hold on tight. It's not my place to question, only God knows why. I'm just jealous of the angels around the throne tonight, singing hallelujah.
That you made a no matter what you're going through. I know that you can stand, for your life is in His hand.
Hallelujah.
what you're going through. His grace and mercy do it for him. He loves you. I know he does. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah.
From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. 'Cause all my life you have been faithful. Of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. In darkest night, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. I have lived in the goodness of God. Hey! 'Cause all my life you have been faithful.
Oh, yes, you have.
And all my life you have been so, so good. Every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Your
stand. I know that my Redeemer liveth, and that he shall stand at the latter day upon the earth. And though after my skin worms destroy this body, yet in my flesh shall I see God, whom I shall see for myself, and my eyes shall behold, and not another. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore will not we fear, though the earth be removed, and though the mountains be carried into the midst of the sea, though the waters thereof roar and be troubled, though the mountains shake with the swelling thereof. Verily, verily, I say unto you, the hour is coming, and now is when the dead shall hear the voice of the Son of God, and there that hear shall live. I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. Blessed be God, even the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and the God of all comfort, who comfort us in all our tribulation, that we may be able to comfort them which are in any trouble, by the comfort wherewith we ourselves are comforted of God. Amen. You may be seated. Let me say good morning to all of you here gathered in this sanctuary, and those of you who are following online. Let me say special good morning to the minister Wilfred Abrahams and his wife, and the honorable, let me say good morning to our General Superintendent, the Reverend Dr. Joel Cumberbatch, Reverend Hainsley Griffith, our officiating minister as well. Good morning to the Honorable Wilfred Abrahams and his wife, the Chief Prison Officer, Mark Corbin, and to Colonel John Nurse and Mrs. Sophia Nurse. Good morning to one and all, the entire congregation, any other religious ministers attending this service, any other ministers of government or officials attending this service, good morning to you. We are here this morning with one commonality, to give God thanks for the life of our dear Elizabeth Rosemary Beckles Parris. You know, the scripture says that while we do not give God thanks for everything, in everything we must give him thanks. And also, let me say a special good morning to the entire family this morning. We know these circumstances are painful, but you know, part of life is death. We never get acquainted with it, but it is something we all have to go through. So I want to say a good morning to you. Our prayers continually is with you, and we will get through this together in the name of the Lord. And so we give God thanks this morning for our dear sister life, the 53 years that he lent her to us. In whatever capacity this morning, we are going to give God thanks. And we will take comfort that she is really, for me, she's merely asleep in the arms of our Lord and Savior. And so as we open the service this morning, we are going to open with the first hymn, through all the changing scenes of life.
This morning, we acknowledge and accept that you are the sovereign, supreme God, whose power, knowledge, and presence is matchless. This morning, we acknowledge it's because of your grace and mercy and unconditional love that we are here. And so we thank you for this day and the new mercies you have extended to us once again. Father, this morning we want to thank you for the life of our dear sister, Elizabeth Rosemary Beckles Harris. We thank you for the 53 years you have lent her to us in whatever capacity. A daughter, a wife, a mother, a sister, and whatever other capacity. We thank you for your love for her, the mercy and the grace you extended to her. She came, no doubt, into this life with a plan and purpose. And we have no doubt that in those short 53 years, she has fulfilled all that she wanted to. And Father, you've seen it fit to call her to her rest. We are comforted this day, Lord, that she's not lost eternally, but she has merely fallen asleep in your arms. And so, Father, you take all the praise and the glory and the honor as only you can in whatever circumstance. Help us as we would continue this service, Lord. Guide us, Lord, as we proceed. And at the end of it all, we pray that it will have gone up to you, Lord, as a sweet-smelling savor to your nostrils. Because in every circumstance, your name must be glorified. This prayer I pray in your name, and no other name but the precious name of Jesus, with thanksgiving. Amen. Amen. You may be seated.
I just want to say briefly, Elizabeth became part of the Woburn Church family 9 years ago because of her marriage to Ashton Parris, a long-standing member of our church. And for me, she was a very unassuming young lady with a hearty laugh. You would have to look good to see when she was in church. She was so quiet, but could she laugh? I remember our last session in the Sunday school class, and she was very interactive in the Sunday school sessions. And that particular morning, we were discussing something in relation to family issues. And I can't remember what it is that I shared, but that morning, Elizabeth laughed till she shook, literally shook. And I would hold on to that memory because that was the first last time I saw her alive. She was also a loving, dedicated wife. And you know, during a recent conversation with Ashton, he said a most beautiful thing to me. He said, Liz understood that as husband and father, he was the head of the household. But she was right there with him because she was the neck. And we all know the head can't go anywhere without the neck, and the neck can't go anywhere without the head. And so we that is a testimony to the cooperation they shared in that family union. She also was a devoted mother to her two lovely children, who are very active members of our Sunday school class as well. And so I would just want to say to her grieving family, members Ashton, Alyssa, Aaron, Mummy Beckles, Antonia, Philip, and the extended family, we the church family at Woburn extend our heartfelt condolences to all of you. Personally, me, myself and my family also extend condolences. And to Mummy Beckles, I just want to say to you, Camelia saying her heartfelt condolences to you. You know the relation that you and she have. She's very sorry that she couldn't be here today, but because of work commitments. But she's saying her heartfelt condolences to you. I pray that God will continue to strengthen and keep all of you together. And I want you to hold on to the memories of daughter, mother, sister, whatever capacity. Amen. At this time, we will have the first scripture reading from John 14, 1 to 6 by Kathy Ann Beckles. And immediately after, there will be a tribute by Antoinette Morris on behalf of the Barbados Light and Power.
Good morning.
The first scripture reading is taken from John chapter 14, verses 1 to 6. Do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. My Father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, would I have told you that I am going to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. You know the way to the place where I'm going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we don't know where you are going, so how can we know the way? Jesus answered, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Here ends the reading.
Good morning. I'm not Annette Morrison. This is Annette Morrison. But this morning I'll be sharing delivery of the tribute on behalf of Leighton Poor with Annette. She was a gem of BLPC, an exemplary colleague who touched the lives of many. That was our Elizabeth Beckles Paris. An executive assistant who supported the directors of finance and shared services at the time of her passing, had served Leighton Poor for 25 years. Throughout her tenure, there was always movement in her career, from secretary to administrative assistant, then assuming her last role as executive assistant. But anyone who knew Liz, as she was affectionately called, also knew that her most important role was that of wife to Ashton and mother to Alyssa and Aaron. There are not enough words to describe our beloved Liz. Professional, warm, and kind, infectious laugh we just heard about, a wonderful person, irreplaceable, a true friend, honest and real to the core, endearing, caring, meticulous, positive work ethic, wealth of organizational knowledge, thorough, incredibly resourceful, bundle of joy, and master encourager. Expressions of love and admiration for Liz came from many of her former colleagues, and it is only fitting that we share these sentiments that came straight from the hearts of those who interacted with her at BLPC. And these are just a few that I will share with you. There are many more. Liz will always be invaluable to Leighton Poor as someone who had things under control and missed nothing, as she frequently backfilled for me in my absence. Not only will she be remembered for her positive demeanor at work, but we will not forget her unwavering commitment to her husband and children, as she spoke of them so often and lovingly. Liz, may you find peace everlasting. Liz's final work project was the Leighton Poor 2024 calendar. She contacted the communications team to ensure her edits were received, as always very thorough and very meticulous. No other editor's response looked like Liz's. So when you receive your calendar this year, know that Liz had much to do with its content and presentation. The team will treasure and miss you dearly, Liz. Liz's vibrant spirit infused joy into our work environment. Her intentional, organized approach made collaboration a delight. And I may add that she was skilled at ensuring success in shared projects. She showed so much care for people in tangible ways, as she was positive and uplifting, affirming and encouraging. I remember her going out of her way to satisfy my pregnancy craving for tamarind. I treasured her motherhood wisdom as she reminded me of the importance of self-care. Liz during Christmas time is a favorite memory as we shared holiday plans, especially gifts for our children. I truly miss her, more so this time of the year. And this one is my personal recollection and memory that I will share with you. It's hard to overstate the profound impact Liz had on our workplace and on our lives. She was not just a colleague, but a pillar of knowledge, kindness, and support. Her deep understanding and extensive institutional knowledge, especially in HR matters, made her the go-to person for many across the organization. Her supportive nature went well beyond the ordinary professional expectations. She would often check whether I had taken a lunch break, reminding me of the importance of self-care. Her thoughtful gestures, like stocking the kitchenette with drinks to ensure I stayed hydrated during busy periods, were small acts of kindness that spoke volumes about her caring personality. We shared a love for food, and I fondly recall her recently joining me with her family for the Who Says Men Can't Cook competition, supporting and cheering me on. A family person at heart, Liz cherished her family. Our conversations often revolved around her children's achievements. Her eyes would light up with pride while talking about them. For example, in our very last conversation when we discussed Alyssa's involvement in the Barbados Youth Orchestra. These conversations were a testament to her loving and nurturing spirit. As we bid farewell to Liz, we acknowledge the void she leaves behind. Her memory will continue to inspire and guide us. She will be dearly missed, not just as a colleague, but as a treasured friend and an exemplary human being. And I now pass the mic over to Annette Morrison, our Director of Shared Services.
Thank you. This could go on all day, but we had to choose a few. And so I'll share some additional memories, loving memories of our dear Liz. I love how she loved her family and would go to the ends of the earth to ensure that her children's needs, including academic pursuits, were met. I loved her frank and open conversations about different matters and experiences. I loved how she interacted and treated everyone with respect, regardless of their rank. Despite being busy with work tasks, always finding the time to encourage others. I loved how she would suddenly burst into song, sometimes off key, but nonetheless singing at the top of her voice. I loved that she was a foodie who ate and enjoyed eating. Persons would always ask, "What did Ashton cook?" And she would share in detail the goodies in her lunch bag, enjoying all the delicacies. Affectionately called Lilibet, she was one who was admired for constantly wearing a pleasant smile and maintaining professionalism even under difficult circumstances. Her laughter was contagious, and she was one of the most reliable and competent women we knew. She was a friend, a source of comfort with her words of kindness and encouragement. Her selflessness and effervescent laughter made it easy to be around her. As we mourn our friend and colleague, let us remember she was the epitome of professionalism, and her indelible contributions and unmatched passion were 100%. Sitting with Liz 25 years ago at the lunch table changed everything for this employee. A close bond was formed thereafter, having meals and exercising around the garrison after work. Liz became that person's supervisor 2 years afterwards in the HR department, and was instrumental in developing her administrative and secretarial skills. When Liz offered to plan her wedding, that person had no reservation, giving full rein to Liz, knowing how thorough she was. The day before the wedding, Liz sent her a 21 bullet point document with the order of service. And the person recalled the event coordinator calling to commend Liz on how detailed her information was and how she knew exactly what was required, despite not being the bride herself. But that was how well Liz knew that individual. The person both focused herself and Liz on their children, attending birthday parties and doing things together as doting mothers. Despite Liz being transferred to another department, they were able to connect, even though they both had two young children and were focusing on studies at the time. Liz always found time to get involved in church activities, balancing the needs of her family at the same time. Everything Liz did was for her husband and children. And this person, as this individual reflected on their personal journey with Liz throughout their professional and personal relationship, She said, despite the pain I now feel from the loss of my dear friend, I can smile at the wonderful memories that I will continue to treasure. Meeting Liz in April 2007, when I was at temp, unknown to me was that during my first week, she was assessing whether to keep me. Her words. And at the end of the week, she told me she was keeping me. Our relationship grew into a deep friendship and a close bond that lasted until her passing. Liz was such a sweet person, difficult to describe because she had so many wonderful qualities: loyal, trustworthy, dedicated, honest, principled, kind-hearted, and I could go on and on. Not to mention her strong work ethic, especially as a supervisor. At times, when they disagreed, there was still mutual respect for each other, built on the fundamental principles of right and wrong, as only Liz knew how to operate. She had the biggest laugh, a sound that I will truly miss. Liz's relationship with God truly mattered, and she lived her life exhibiting God's favor. She often said, it's in Jehovah's hands now. And that is a place where our beloved Liz now resides. So the journey of Elizabeth Beckles Paris has ended, but her legacy lives on, not only at Light and Power, but amongst everybody here and the wider community. Liz would encourage us to live a life of faith, service, and care. To love God, life, and family. And so, although Liv has passed on, her memory forever stays. Remember how she smiled and the joy she always gave. We'll miss her all the time and think of her every day. Her life filled the world, and that is a love that will never fade. I know God has a plan. We all do. But I'm sure you share with me that this particular plan is difficult to understand. But what I can say is, Liz, sleep well, my sister.
Thank you for those warm tributes on the behalf of Elizabeth. I'm listening to her professionalism and her work ethic. I'm sure the Barbados Light and Power have the person says, I am Light and Power. Those tributes can testify to the fact that Elizabeth was also Light and Power, and Light and Power was Elizabeth. Thank you. At this time, we will have a tribute and song by the Barbados Light and Power Choir, followed by the second scripture reading taken from 2 Timothy 4, 7-8 by Denise Hines.
Thank you. Good morning, church. Scripture reading is taken from 2 Timothy chapter 4, reading from verse 7 and 8. I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day. And not to me only, but unto all them also that love his appearing. Here ends the reading of God's word.
Yes, Elizabeth has fought a good fight and she has finished her course. At this time, we will have the hymn, Great is Thy Faithfulness. And indeed, God's faithfulness is great. There is no shadow of turning with him. Amen. You may be seated. Our God is indeed an all-sufficient God. At this time, we will have the eulogy by Elizabeth Brothers, Antonia and Philip Beckles, followed by a musical tribute by the Woburn Quartet.
Good morning, everyone. And thank you all for coming. We never imagined that we would be here today doing this, but here we are. My name is Antonio, and with me is my brother Philip, and we're Elizabeth's brothers. Liz was 3 years older than I am and about 10 years older than my brother Phil. Even though we're both younger than she is, Liz would often say that she had a younger brother and a little brother. And today, we are charged with delivering the eulogy for our big sister. Something that is genuinely heartbreaking, but at the same time, something that we are both honored to do, because indeed, our sister was an incredible woman.
Anyone that knew Liz knew that she was really an amazing person. She was a devoted mother, a loyal wife, a thoughtful daughter, and a faithful Christian. From our perspective, she was also a very compassionate sister, and I think that everyone would agree that she was thorough, she was organized, and she was efficient. But she was also so much more.
Liz was born in 1970 to our parents, John and Marcella Beckles. She and I spent our first years growing up in Tichborne, Horace Cross Road, at our grandmother's home. She was the first of my grandmother's grandchildren, and as such, was doted on by my mom and her siblings. And as they understand it, they would dress her like a little doll and take her for long strolls throughout the neighborhood, with everyone commenting what a beautiful baby she was. At age 5, Liz would attend the Belmont Primary School, which I also attended on reaching age 5. Looking back, I can say from an early age, she was always a good role model for me. Some of my earliest memories of her involve her participating in brownies at primary school. I would watch her troop meetings after school while waiting to be collected by our grandmother. The fun they had as a group was what prompted me to ask my parents to join the Cub Scouts when I was old enough. In fact, I knew the brownie promise long before I became a Cub Scout. A promise they would repeat after each meeting went like this. I promise that I will do my best to do my duty to God and my country, to help other people, and to keep the Brownie Guide law. And the Brownie's law stated, a Brownie Guide thinks of others before themselves and does a good turn every day. This was true to both the Brownie promise and followed the law all her life. When Liz was around 7, we moved to Bridge Road for a few years before our family finally settled in Welch's Terrace, where our parents moved so that they could look after our grandfather on our dad's side. At this point, Mom said that we were old enough for some responsibility, so we were given chores to do around the house, and we would take turns doing them. Washing up the dishes after meals, taking out the garbage, and feeding the animals, of which there were many. I remember Liz was always very good with getting her chores completed. Me, on the other hand, not so much. Liz was always reliable. She knew what she had to do, and she got it done. In addition to attending the same primary school, Liz and I also attended the same secondary school together, Covermere School. And even though we did not have a lot of interaction at school, I always had a sense of comfort knowing that my big sister was around if ever there was a problem. She was a conscientious student. Liz would study hard and always expected the return on her dedication. I remember as kids struggling to get grades within the 70% range and feeling quite pleased with myself when I did, while my sister would quite often challenge teachers when she got less than a perfect score in any test she took. How did I lose marks here, she would ask, when her test script was returned, and head off to the teacher to sit and lobby for her missing marks. She always believed anything worth doing should be done to the best of one's ability. In addition to being a good student, Liz was also a shrewd business person from a very young age. She would always save her allowance, while I would generally waste mine on frivolous purchases. Now, when it came time to buy something that I really wanted, my big sister would always be there to loan me the money. Of course, there was always the stipulation that I would need to pay her back with interest when our allowance came around again. I also recall at our home in Welch's, there were two large mango trees in our backyard. And at that time, we lived right next to the Robert Manufacturing Company. As a means of making additional pocket money over the summer vacation, Liz came up with the idea of selling mangoes to the staff of the company as they passed by the house for work. A neat little cardboard sign was constructed saying, "Mangoes for sale, 5 for $1. Originally, I protested, saying that we could make more money if we sold them at 1 for 25 cents. But Liz said selling one at 25 cents did not provide as much incentive for persons to buy as selling 5 for $1, since people would be getting a bargain, or think they were getting a bargain of an extra mango, and they also had to buy in bulk, which would allow us to get the mangoes from around the house. She would also inspect the mangoes and ensure that there were any that were not up to standard, were too small or had spots, would not be bagged for sale. We made amazing sales over the summer. Liz also always made sure that any of her major purchases were an investment. She bought an electric typewriter and learned to type at amazing speeds, a skill which she used throughout her career. And then she bought her first computer a few years later and immediately taught herself desktop publishing and generated more than enough money to cover the cost of the computer times over. I remember her cooking well. As a teenager, Mom let Liz practice her cooking on weekends. And in those days, her hand was extremely heavy with the pepper. I remember every time Liz cooked sitting at the table with a large pitcher of cold water and taking a sip from a glass after every forkful. But so flavorful was the food that you had to keep eating. Thankfully, it got much milder in the following years. Liz also made a fantastic gooseberry jam. I was always amazed how she could turn something so tart into something so delicious. On weekends, we'd pick wild gooseberries from the open pasture across from our home, and she would spend the afternoon making the jam. She also learned to bake from Mom. I would make sweet bread, scones, and quiche to the delight of Phil and myself.
Well, when I came along, I remember, as Antonio indicated, our parents raised all kinds of animals, including rabbits, ducks, chickens, turkeys, pigs, even goats. In fact, one of my clearest memories as a boy was the three of us, Liz, Tony, and myself, taking the goats to the bottom of the gap across the road to the pasture to graze, and then bringing them back in our evenings. When I was really young, maybe around 3 or so, I actually remember Liz coming home from school, and at that time it would have been Commonmere, and reading stories to me while still in her khaki school uniform. And then, when she moved from 3rd to 4th form and left behind her overalls, I remember Tony and I would use them by pretending to be Shaolin monks and practicing Kung Fu in the yard. But Liz didn't care about any of that, any of our antics. Once she had a good book to read. In fact, when we were growing up, her favorite place to be simply was reading, was in her room, reading book after book, day after day.
My sister loved reading from as far back as I can remember. She started with Lady Bird 1, 2, 3 books, then on to other children's books by Enid Blyton, books like The Folks of the Faraway Tree, The Famous Five, and Amelia Jane. These were some of her favorites. She also enjoyed reading Nancy Drew and Hardy Boy mystery books. Liz then moved on to novels from authors like Sidney Sheldon, Agatha Christie, Daniel Steele, and Stephen King. I hated reading as a child, but on long rainy summer days when you could not go outside to play, I watched my sister disappear to faraway places via the magic of words and her imagination, and this encouraged me to do the same. She had an impressive reading speed, routinely reading a novel in a day, and as such, our uncle Wilfred used to affectionately refer to her by the name Bookworm.
in her teen years, she became really active here at Carrington's Wesleyan. She sang in the Clavinova Choir, and did missionary work in Jamaica, and assisted in Vacation Bible School during the summer. In fact, her first job after graduating school was working here at Carrington's as church secretary for the then pastor, Hansy Griffith, who's officiating today. If my memory serves, it was here that she met her husband, Ashton. You see, in 1994, the prison service had a special tribute hosted here at Carrington's, and Ashton took that opportunity to introduce himself to Liz. I remember him coming over to the house in the evenings, and the two of them would sit in the patio and talk for hours. And this was interesting for me for two reasons. Number one, those were the days when people used to court each other, which is something you don't really see anymore. And even though it's old-fashioned, it's quite useful to everyone involved, because the family would get a sense of the guy that was coming around, and the guy gets a sense of the family he was working toward. And that mutual understanding helps both parties going forward. But the other reason why they would spend hours in the patio talking is because my father was very strict. You couldn't just come into my father's house to his daughter. You would have had to have been crazy. There were rules that you had to obey, and there were protocols that you had to observe. But the thing about Ashton is that he was an officer. So recognizing protocol and observing rules and regulations was something that was very familiar with him. I think I can say that when we all met Ashton, the family got along really well with him. In fact, on occasion, he helped our father do some tiling around the house. And often while Ashton was working, Dad and him would sit and talk together. I would actually say that Ashton and my father got along really well. And in 1998, I believe Liz started working at Light and Power as a manager secretary. She was stationed at a garrison location and worked for her then manager, Hartley Richards. Mr. Richards was not just her boss, but also a mentor, and their relationship mirrored more of a father and daughter than simply a boss and employee. And they continued like that until they retired. She was shortly afterwards relocated to the Spring Garden location, where she worked with then-manager Wayne Yearwood for about 6 months before returning to the garrison station, where she would go on to work for Haynes the Sobers, Roger Bamaran, Natalie Abrams, and then finally Annette Morrison as an executive assistant.
Liz was a committed and dedicated employee. Many evenings we would meet her at Mom's house after work. She would generally arrive between 5 and 7 p.m., sometimes looking very tired after a hard day's work. I remember her often saying, "I had to stay late to push ahead with my work, needed to get it done." Liz always put in her time, and she always got the task completed.
When Liz first relocated to the garrison complex from Spring Garden, around that time, she and I moved to Carrington Village, and we lived there for about 8 years together. I remember I was fresh out of UE, and there was nothing I wanted more than to simply be a carefree young man. However, that was far from the reality that I now had. Gone were the days when leaving the shoes at the door when you came in was acceptable. That couldn't happen anymore. Gone were the days when leaving unwashed dishes in the sink was a thing. I would have had to have been crazy. Everything had a place and a way that it should be done, down to how ice cubes should be put in the freezer. And you had better remember to put things back where you took them from, or you'd be managing a situation you wish you would have simply just avoided. The thing is, though, through all that, Liz was also a very girly girl. Growing up, her favorite color was unapologetically pink, and she had long black hair that many girls couldn't believe was real. The house was always had to be done and decorated for Christmas, and she would bake ham and prepare food for everyone. I actually remember one Christmas where Liz hosted a family get together in Carrington Village, and to me that was amazing because we didn't have a lot of space, but we had a lot of family. So for me, it could be a very difficult thing to reconcile because on one hand, she was so girly and a homemaker, and on the other hand, she almost felt military. I felt like I was often living with Drill Sergeant Barbie. But through all of this, I knew that my sister loved me. She made it glaringly obvious to everyone that knew her that family was very important to her. Liz is actually the person that taught me how to cook. And as I guess you would have heard from Antonio, she had her own culinary journey growing up. But Liz made sure that I could handle myself in the kitchen. I remember the first thing she taught me was how to make macaroni pie and how to season chicken, something that served me well when I was in England studying. Liz even used to vet the women in my life, from the, I like her, Phil, she seems nice, down to the, you know, I always have my issues with she, Phil. Not surprisingly, Liz helped me through some very difficult times in my life, encouraging me and giving me advice while patiently letting me know, all right, you got to work past this now, Phil. Liz also showed me that we shouldn't limit ourselves because of the situations we find ourselves in. She completed both her bachelor's and master's degrees with distinction while working full-time at Barbara's Light & Power and raising two children. All this while being a committed wife, daughter, mother, sister, and employee. Liz had a direct impact on me being the man that I am today. Liz was an inspiration, and she was a rock. And in 2009, when she moved to St. George with her now husband, Ashton, after some initial challenges, Alyssa came along. And everyone was so happy for Liz because we knew she always wanted to be your mother, and now Alyssa was going to be the beginning of that journey. And just short and unexpected 2 years later, Aaron came along as well. And I remember that pregnancy because I remember when the doctor, and I think at the time it would have been Dr. Thomas, gave Liz a due date of delivery. And when Aaron was born, he said, "Whoa, your son came in right on the date that I was thinking, how amazing." I remember telling myself, "This man obviously does not know my sister." Because if he did, he would know that Liz always meets her deadlines. And plus, now it worked out that both kids share a birthday. Liz was on time and Liz was efficient.
Liz was our mom's only daughter, and they shared a special bond. There were many trips to the hairdresser, grocery store, etc. She worked long hours with a hectic schedule, managing office tasks, school pickups and drop-offs, lessons, extracurricular activities for the kids, violin and tennis lessons, and took great pride in watching her kids perform and excel. Liz was always frugal, economical, and prudent. She hated to waste money and would often hesitate to spend money on herself. In 2018, our family took a trip to Disney to the delight of our kids. While at Magic Kingdom, we were passing one of the stores and they suggested we stop in. In there, she saw a beautiful keepsake bracelet, which she quite liked, but indicated that she wasn't going to buy it. She said, "No, the trip is for the kids." I was so glad we convinced her to get it as a memento of the trip and the fun we had as a family visiting Disney with the kids. She wore it every day since and would often remind me of the trip anytime we sat and talked together. She would look at it on her wrist, smile, and laugh. Liz was also a devoted Christian. She loved the Lord and ensured that her family was committed to going to church and raising her kids with good morals and having them develop a relationship with God.
Speaking of her kids, as Alyssa grew, I saw her take on more of a structured and orderly way of thinking that reminded me of her mother. But not only that, Alyssa, in my opinion, is equally girly as well. They both love watching these sentimental Lifetime movies, and whenever we went over to Flat Rock, she and Alyssa would be sitting watching one of these movies while talking about the character's decisions in disbelief. I would normally just sit there and shake my head at them until I slowly found myself engrossed in conversation with the two of them about the same characters in the movie. When I asked Aaron if there was anything that he wanted me to say, anything that he wanted people to remember about his mother, he said, "I want people to remember that she was always willing to stop what she was doing and help other people." He said, no matter what she was in the middle of doing, she would always stop and help him, whether it be a question or with homework or spending time, whatever it was, it didn't matter. And Aaron is right. He's absolutely right. Liz had that part of life figured out. Liz understood that a lot of things that we dedicate our time to, at the end of the day, they simply aren't that important. She made sure to, she would always make time for the important things, specifically God, family, and helping others. And it didn't matter what Liz was doing. She could have had her own stresses or challenges, and she could help you in any way or make a recommendation of somebody who could. You could be sure that you would get a call, a WhatsApp message, or an email pointing you in a direction that was sure to help. Liz was a problem solver. When I asked Ashton if there's anything he wanted me to mention, he said to me, "Phil boy, what is there to say? Liz was a wonderful wife, a devoted mother, and I loved her with everything." Philip, they ain't got no words. Ashton, my brother, it is true. There are no words, there really aren't. For something like this, the suddenness of this, the unexpectedness of this, words just are not enough. Because we all saw Liz's devotion to you and to your family. And the truth is frequently when you saw one of them, you would see them all. Like I said before, to Liz, family was really important. And when it came to Liz and Mom, they had a really close bond from her early years that continued all the way into her adulthood. I saw their relationship move from mother and daughter to what I would describe as two friends who loved talking and spending time together. They bonded through not only being wives, but also through being mothers. So much so that it often seemed like they had secret conversations and understandings that Tony and I couldn't figure out. Between Liz and Ashton, they were always bringing food for Mom. Liz would pay certain bills for Mom, and she would always ensure that the kids got to spend time with their grandmother. Liz made spending time and taking care of Mom a priority.
And Mom was always proud of Liz. Proud of the fact that she never simply rested on the 98%, but instead tried to figure out how she could achieve the outstanding 2. Liz always wanted to do her best. And because of that, we believe that the scripture verse 2 Timothy 4:7-8 is more than appropriate. She fought a good fight and finished the race, all while still keeping the faith.
Thank you for all that you gave us, Liz. We will choose to remember the lessons that you modeled in your life. Put God first, keep family close, never be so busy that you can't make time for people, and always do your best. We miss you, and we love you.
Good morning to one and all. The song that we're going to minister this morning is entitled "My Hope Is Built, Cornerstone," and we know that Christ was Liz's cornerstone.
Nothing less. darkness seems to hide his face.
Thank you, Antonio and Philip, for that beautiful eulogy. And yes, God is God through the storm, because indeed he is Lord of all. At this time, we have Reverend Hainsley Griffith, and he will come and share the word of God with us at this time.
Thank you so very much, Reverend Taylor. What a pleasure it is to see all of you on behalf of a very special daughter of mine and family, adopted daughter. I want to say to you how much we appreciate your coming to be with us today. Honorable Winfrey Abrams and Mrs. Abram, Mark Corbin, Chief Officer of the prisons, and Colonel John Nurse, Mrs. Sophia Nurse, really appreciate your coming. Must, of course, thank our Reverend Dr. Joel Cumberbatch as well, who is our General Superintendent, General Superintendent of the entire Caribbean Wesleyan Holiness Church. We want to appreciate, want to give God thanks for his being here with us as well, and of course, the other ministers who are present. Liz was a very special daughter to me for almost 35 years. We've had that bond, and she was my first secretary, and everything that was actually said from the Light and Power in terms of her being a perfectionist, in terms of her character, in terms of a sharpness of a focus, a brilliant mind, and one who was very concerned about the welfare of people, and of course, you've heard it over and over, a family woman. Ashton became a son of mine as well, and Alyssa and Aaron, they have been embraced into my arms as well. So you can imagine the depth of our pain, but also the joy of allowing, of seeing the impact, significant impact she has had on the lives of so many people, not only here in Barbados, but beyond Barbados. Death. Let's face its reality. Billy Graham once said, no matter how prepared you think you are for the death of a loved one, it still comes as a shock, and it still hurts very deeply. When a young person, I put her in that category, is suddenly removed from family, friends, and loved ones at the takeoff, in my opinion, takeoff point in their life, it presents a great challenge to all and sundry. Such is the case with Elizabeth Rosemary Beckles, who departed from us unannounced, leaving behind a trail of unanswered questions, and at the same time, throwing many relatives and friends into shock and sorrow and sadness. This painful time brings into sharp focus that youth is no guarantee of long life, and therefore such a reality should register in our minds that what Psalm 103, 15 to 17 says, as for a man, as for man or mankind, his days are like grass, like a flower of the field, so he flourishes. For the wind passes over it, and it is no more. And its place knows it no longer. There are several things in life that can be ignored, but death is not one of them. It is mankind's constant, current companion. According to Ecology Global Network, 55.3 million people are taken out of this world by the icy arms of death every year. Death has been able to, quote unquote, live for centuries. And no human being has been able to kill, quote unquote, kill it. It takes the breath away from the biggest and the smallest, the richest, the poorest, strongest and weakest, powerful and powerless. It does not entertain friends or favorites, nor does it give preferential treatment to those who are famous or infamous. Day after day, week after week, month after month, this elusive enemy has successfully entered the domain of many families, fatally assaulting loved ones, and never spent one day in solitary confinement for its dreadful deeds. One thing is certain. This merciless monster is coming for you and for me. And you cannot avoid or elude it. You are on its hit list. The Holy Bible infers that in mankind's lifetime, he will have several enemies, some of which he may be able to destroy, but death is not one of those foes he has the power to eliminate. A brief look at this mistake mysterious monster which many over the centuries have vainly tried to describe will occupy our attention for the next few moments. There is no narrative in the Holy Scriptures that grip me more than the life of Job, whose intimacy with God, integrity, and humility shone like a beacon in the midst of the dense moral darkness and that pervaded society in his day. Job had a flawless character, some fine children, favorable capital, and a strong family commitment. He was the chief justice in his country, if you were not aware of that, and that was Arabia. A social activist, philanthropist, lover of young people, counselor, educator, highly respected by people of all classes across the then known world. One day, all 10 of his grown children died suddenly in a tragic incident. He buckled under the weight of the sudden news. It was too much for him. When he gradually, but feebly got back his composure, he could not explain the death. He certainly did not expect it, and obviously did not invite it. But eventually, he was able to bring a perspective to it. He said, quote, "I came into the world with nothing, and the Lord chose to give me all that I possess, including my children." For him, it was a reflection of God's choosing to give him the gifts of his children. "The Lord giveth," was his expression. And therefore, cherishing the memory of such gifts must always be kept in view. He went on to tearfully say, quote, "I know at some time God will take them away from me. And the time has come," he said, "the Lord has taken away. He has chosen to take back his gift because it was his in the first place." That final verse in the book attributed to his name, Job, chapter 1. Verse 22 sharpened the focus for me, and I hope for you, the grieving relatives and friends, when it reads, "Job did not sin, nor did he blame God with any wrongdoing." Death paralyzes. When death strikes, the emotional paralysis that occurs in the lives of individuals cannot be articulated in words. I have witnessed some of the toughest and strongest of individuals collapse emotionally under the power of the sting of death. In their moments of distress, they sometimes did and said things that were not always characteristic of their normal behavior. Physically, I have also observed individuals who crumbled under the weight of death when it struck family and friends. Some have had to get medical attention as a result. The denial, confusion, forgetfulness, intrusive thoughts, fears, and anxiety are just a few of the mental and emotional discomforts that frequently assault the mind when death makes its presence felt. The social impact is not always an easy thing with which to grapple when death pounces on a cherished individual like my adopted daughter. The social disconnect from mother and father and spouse and children and siblings and colleagues and friends and others with whom intimate relationships were forged over an extended period of time cannot be measured by any stretch of the imagination. Spiritually, many a religious person's stability is not always shaken, is always shaken, but also shattered as God is sometimes blamed for the death of their cherished ones. I remember a young man who got extremely angry with God when his father, a young man of the clergy, died. He wanted nothing to do with God or things relating to God. However, when I met him a few years later, he had put things in perspective and had built an intimate relationship with God. The question that still remains for many is, can this most feared enemy called death, which has and continues to terrify so many over the centuries, can be defeated or perhaps destroyed? Listen to Job again, in chapter 19, in verse 25 through 27, he said, "For I know," not I think, "I know that my Redeemer and Vindicator lives, and at the last he will take his hand upon the earth, even after my mortal skin is destroyed by death. Yet, from my immortal flesh, I will see God, whom I, even I, will see for myself, and my eyes will see him, and not another." What comforting words. Yes, death paralyzes, but let's look at death demise. Yes, if death cannot self-destruct, and no human being has found a key to unlock the mystery of its ability to live on, quote unquote, with an almost perfect success record, then the question remains, does death have the final say over the destiny of humanity? Among all the religions in the world, past and present, none apart from Christianity has claimed with any confidence that their founder has ever conquered death. One of the most brilliant Jewish scholar, researcher, and leading high-profile attorney at law, the Apostle Paul, who confessed that he was once an enemy of Christianity, raise a powerful question in his argument about the issue of death and its demise in his first letter to the Corinthians, chapter 15. He implied that with death attacking and defeating mankind in all areas of their existence, this life in which we live, even with all its benefits, offers mountains of misery, he said, and hopelessness. He went on, however, to add that when Jesus Christ died, he rose from the dead. He brought hope and happiness to humanity beyond the power of death and the grave. The founder of Christianity himself rose from the dead, yes, and appeared to his disciples for a period of 40 days after his resurrection as evidence of his power over death. In the book of Revelation, chapter 1, verse 17 and 18 verses, he said to the Apostle John on the Isles of Patmos, "I died, but see, I am alive forevermore, and I have the keys of the authority, absolute control and victory over death and of the realm of the dead." No other religious leader has ever been able to unquestionably make such a claim. Death, therefore, for the Christian does not have any final grip on humanity. This last enemy to be destroyed will not be able to do any permanent damage to those whose faith and confidence is in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Paul, under inspiration, said, "For to be absent from this body is to be present with the Lord." To the gangster on the cross who exercised faith in Jesus Christ, the words from the one who is the resurrection and the life. He heard these words, today, you will be with me in paradise. In light, therefore, of what we've shared, please make sure your ear is attentive to skillful and godly wisdom and apply your heart to understanding, seeing it conscientiously and striving for it eagerly. Please, the strong embrace of God is with her. And those of us, and those of you who commit yourself unreservedly to the one who is the resurrection and the life, we'll see her again. And I pray God's blessing on every one of us today as we reflect on these words shared from the Holy Scriptures. Amen. Amen. I'm going to ask all the family members to stand at this time as I offer a prayer for you. Father, it is so good to call you Father. It speaks of the intimacy with which we can share, the pleasure in knowing that your eyes are on every heart, even at this time, every family member who is going through this moment of loss. Ashton, no doubt, has buckled under the power and the pressure of this major loss in his life. Alyssa, and Ira, Mom Marcella, Brother Antonio and Philip, and other very close members and relatives. Oh God, I pray today that you would release to them a marvelous sense of your grace, that favor that we don't deserve, but you release it to us and lavish it on us. Nevertheless, do it for this special family today. I pray, Father, that you would grant them your peace, that peace that passes all understanding, that secures our hearts and minds through Christ. Grant to them, Father, stability. Grant to them sharpness of focus. Grant to them a perspective of you that is consistent with your magnitude of your love. And we pray, Father, as they go through this transition, that your presence, they would experience the richness of your presence and the glory of your Holy Spirit's anointing, that they can move through it with the arms of the great I Am. Help them to know that underneath them, above them, around them are the everlasting arms. Thank you, Father. And for all of us present, may we number our days and may we allow ourselves to understand that death will come into our environment at some time, and we need to make sure that we prepare our lives for it by accepting the Lord Jesus Christ into our lives, the one who conquered it and who has come that we may have life and have it in an abundant way. Thank you, Father, for hearing prayer. In Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. You may sit.
Thank you, Reverend Griffith, for that profound message that speaks to death It is, like he said, it's inevitable. We can't do anything about it. But the one thing we can do is to make sure that whenever it comes, that our relationship with God is all right. Because in the end, that is all that's going to matter. We brought nothing into this world. We are not going to carry out anything. All we will do is leave the memories behind. But we are comforted this day to know that though death will come, it does not have the final say. And we take comfort from that. I would like to thank all of you who would have attended physically and all of you who are viewing online of sharing in this Thanksgiving service of the life of Elizabeth Beckles Parris. At this time, let us all stand. We will repeat the benediction, and then we will sing the recessional hymn, The King of Love, My Shepherd Is. May the grace of our Lord and Father Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit rest and abide with us now and forevermore. Amen. God thanks for his grace, his mercy, and his goodness towards us. This portion of the service is over, and we will journey to Coral Ridge for the burial. Thank you once again for attending. Thank you for sharing. And whatever Liz meant to you, hold on to the good memories. God bless.
is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever will be. Great is thy faithfulness.
I surrender my life. I'm in all of see the stars abide. I hear the rolling thunder. Thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to
been closer than you are right now.
Let's sing it all, y'all.
You I can see so clear what it's all about. So stay by my side when the sun goes down.
I know.
Yes, it is. Yes, who you are, way back.
Hey. Let's sing this together. Even when I don't see it. Come on, even when.
Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working.
Come on!
Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop. Above depression, his name is above loneliness. Oh, his name is above disease, his name is above cancer, his name is above every other name.
Your name on high. and never dies. There's a place where streams of grace flow deep and wide, where all the love I've ever found comes like a flood, comes flowing down. At the cross, at the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in all of you, I'm in all of you. Where your love ran red and my sin washed white, I owe all to you, I owe all to you, Jesus. There's a place where sin and shame are powerless, where my heart has peace with God and forgiveness, where all the love I've ever found comes like a flood, comes flowing down. At the cross, at the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in all of you, I'm in all of you. Where your love ran red and my sin washed white, I owe to you, I owe to you.
Good afternoon. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no more sea. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "Now the dwelling of God is with me, and he will live with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and there be no more death, or mourning, or crying, or pain, for the old order of things has passed away. And he who was seated on the throne said, I am making everything new. Then he said, write this down. For these words are trustworthy and true. He said to me, it is done. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. To him who is thirsty, I will give to drink without cost from the spring of living water. He who overcomes will inherit all this, and I will be with him. I will be his God, and he will be my son. For as much as it has pleased Almighty God in his wise providence to take out of this world the soul of our deceased sister, we therefore commit her body to the ground, earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust, looking for the general resurrection in the last day and the life of the world to come through our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose second coming in glorious majesty to judge the world, the earth and the sea, and shall give up their dead. The earth and the sea shall give up their dead, and the corruptible bodies of those who sleep in him shall be changed and made like unto his own glorious body, according to the mighty working whereby he is able to subdue all things unto himself. Reverend Taylor would now pray for us.
Father, we just pause to thank you once again for the life of our dearly departed sister. Father, we are comforted that she has gone on to a better place with you, where there are no more pain, there are no more tears. And for those of us left behind, Lord, continue to strengthen us as only you can. I bring the family to you once again, Lord. You know them by name and nature and what every individual is going through at this time. And whatever they're going through, the commonality is that there is a void in this family. But Father, we are thankful that you are a God who is faithful. You are a God who is compassionate. And so as we say our last goodbyes, Lord, strengthen even now, undergird and comfort as only you can. We release our dear sister to you. We know she's resting peacefully and will live with you in eternity. For those of us who are left behind, help us that we would live ready and prepared lives, that should death come a calling, and we know not when it will come, but we too will be ready to go with you. In Jesus' name I pray with thanksgiving. Amen.
I want you to turn to your hymn sheets as we, on page 9, Blessed Assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine, heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of his spirit, washed in his blood.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine, heir of salvation.
We will have the next hymn, It Is Well With My Soul. Heaven.
Sing the wondrous love of Jesus, sing his mercy and his grace. In the mansions bright and blessed, he'll prepare for us a place. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be when we all see Jesus,
we'll sing
and shout the victory.
in this hymn says, let us then be true and faithful, trusting, serving every day. Just one glimpse of him in glory will the toil of life we pray. And what this hymn is really saying, it will be worth it after all. To God be the glory. We'll sing, to God be the glory. Don't.
Be not dismayed, whatever betide, God will take care of you. Beneath his wings of love abide, God will take care of you. God will take care of you through every day.
Just bow your heads with me, please. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the communion of the Holy Spirit abide with us now and forever. I want to him that is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work in us. To him be glory in the church, in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. And everyone says, amen. Amen. God bless you, the family and all friends. And if we continue to pray for the family, and continue to be there, giving God a very high note of praise for the life, the ministry, and the impact that Liz would have had on thousands of people. God bless you. Have a great evening.
Didn't know today would be your last, or that I'd have to say goodbye to you so fast. I'm so numb I can't feel anymore. I'm praying you'd just walk back through that door and tell me that I was only dreaming. You're not really gone as long as I believe. There will be another angel around the throne tonight. Your love lives on inside of me, and I will hold on tight. It's not my place to question, only God knows why. I'm just jealous of the angels around the throne tonight. Always made my troubles feel so small, and you were always there to catch me when I'd fall. In a world where heroes come and go, well, God just took the only one I know. So I'll hold you as close as I can, longing for the day when I see your face again. But until then, God must need another angel around the throne tonight. Your love lives on inside of me, and I will hold on tight. It's not my place to question, only God knows why. I'm just jealous of the angels around the throne tonight, singing hallelujah. Tonight.